Thank you very much, Pat, for this kind introduction. Thank you very much, UCD, for allowing me to speak this afternoon in front of you. Thanks, of course, for the participants that you are willing to come into this classroom to listen to this presentation, which from more perspectives is quite a challenge. The 40 minutes is a challenge because the ambitious title could well take us into 4 or 5 hours of lecturing. Secondly, the ongoing confusion, I would say, in the humanitarian domain is also in itself a challenge to tackle and to pretend indeed that the reconceptualization in humanitarianism is a possibility. But okay, we will return to this later on. I suppose that the lecture will be made available to you in printed form, so then you will also have the links of who I am, although Pat, of course, already gave quite a good summary. Behind these links, you will find my daily occupation in the University of Groningen in particular, but globally, so to speak, worldwide. Today, I would like to address the issue of indeed the necessity for the humanitarian community, for the humanitarian domain, to come to grips with the 21st century challenges that are in existence and that determine indeed not only a willingness to discuss the fundamental concepts and definitions of what humanitarianism is, but also the courage to perhaps let go of a very fixed 150 years of humanitarianism. That's, for argument's sake, say since 1864 that the International Committee of the Red Cross and Red Crescent Society was being created into the 21st century, that has created a different playing field than what the humanitarians have been used to or what they are willing to be used to. And that's indeed, let's say, the overarching theme of today's class that is subdivided in the way as you see on the screen. The principled approach to humanitarianism, the present-day challenges, all coming together in this so-called WHS, the World Humanitarian Summit, that was conducted in Istanbul in May 2016, where NOHA, the Network on Humanitarian Action, which I also represent next to the University of Groningen, of course, where NOHA made a considerable contribution to put flesh to the bones of this wake-up call and to put forward ideas on how we should get to this possible shift in conceptual approach to humanitarianism, shift in the paradigm that is being up so far used to position humanitarianism in the international domain and to pinpoint down what humanitarianism is and what it can be and what it cannot be. So that is indeed the structure of this lecture. And of course, I hope to arrive at conclusions. But as I said already in my opening statement, perhaps it's still too early for conclusions. And the only conclusion can be that there is a further necessity to engage in this effective dialogue between all humanitarian stakeholders that are meeting one another in the humanitarian space so often and so intensely. And then perhaps the next slide is not really fair, but I decided to select it anyway because quite a few of these 21st century challenges are coming together in this simple picture. And everybody knows, no doubt, what has happened to Oxfam over the past couple of days, ending up in a huge scandal about conduct of their staff members in the disaster response in Haiti after the big earthquake in 2010. And why do I believe that this, and again, although it's not nice to Oxfam, why do I think that this simple photo represents very well the content of my lecture today? First and foremost, if only because of the complexity of the disaster that took place in Haiti in 2010, a simple earthquake, which turned out to be not a simple earthquake at all. A representation of the highly complex nature of present-day both natural as well as man-made disasters. A multitude of actors coming into the area to deliver aid after disaster struck. A decimated government that already was not the strongest governance machinery on Earth before the earthquake struck in Haiti. Political presence of a variety of great powers, the United States of America, the Russian Federation, France, that demanded a role to play. Contingents of blue helmets, the United Nations staff members from different parts of the world who were fully not able to work effectively in the context in which they were asked to operate. And then again, also a multitude of non-governmental agencies providing aid, but also very much interested in their donor-agency relationship. In other words, to showcase the necessity of them there working and the necessity of showcasing their needs for continuous funding. So I'm not even referring to the actual misconduct that has been done by the Oxfam staff members, but I'm more relating to the dynamics and the complexity of the situation as it occurred in Haiti 2010, that also finally represents the image of humanitarianism in a way that can be labeled representational for the past 150 years. That there is a huge power balance in between those who are coming in to deliver aid and those who are receiving aid. There's a disturbed balance between the recipients of aid that are depicted as victims without rights, without possibilities, without capacities, that are fully dependent upon the goodness of the Samaritans that have come into the issue, into the area, to deliver their wonderful charitable aid to the victims of a disaster, in this case a natural disaster. So I'm not speaking out on the validity of the claim that indeed these Oxfam staff members were engaged in sexual activities, making use of prostitutes of minor age. That's not proper English, but you get my point. But it's a clear depiction of indeed this rather old-fashioned approach that has become so dominant in international humanitarianism. The good donors coming in to deliver aid to the powerless beneficiaries, recipients of aid, who don't have any say, so to speak, in what is happening to them, even when they are getting abused. So apologies to Oxfam, but it was too good an example to let go by. And it gives me the clue to continue in my presentation by asking a few moments of your time on how the humanitarian community got so much stuck into this donor-recipient, humanitarian aid deliverant recipient modus, in which in the end there is so little room for the recipients of aid to be considered, to be depicted as people who still have rights, and people who still have capacities, even though at the very moment that disaster strikes, their normal lives are being disrupted. And they are partially dependent upon outside help to restore their livelihoods. And that is, in principle, a very long story that I summarized very shortly here in this slide. That basically what has been created since, already mentioned, the origins of the International Red Cross, 1864, there has been created a legal humanitarian, so to speak, a legal humanitarian that progressively over the past 150 years have been delineating itself in legal terms what humanitarian is and what humanitarianism is supposed to be, and oppositely, who is not to be considered as a humanitarian. Sir, you wanted to ask something? Oh, sorry. Yeah, this simple slide covers 150 years of carefully crafting this internationalized legal body, delineating what humanitarianism is and what it isn't. You will agree that over the years, via international humanitarian law, but also the further codification of conducts coming from the organizations itself, more and more the situation is created that international humanitarianism is about codified rules and regulations in which, to which only the true humanitarians can comply. In other words, it has become an exclusive mechanism, this whole history of codification. It has become a mechanism to exclude actors from the humanitarian scene that, in the eyes of the true humanitarians, of the legal humanitarians, did indeed not have a place to be represented in the humanitarian domain. And that has been especially for one particular goal only: to stay away from politics as much as possible. This whole legalizing trend, this whole trend of further legalization, of codification of behavior, rules and regulations, has been for the purpose of singling out the humanitarian community as a standalone community untouched by politics, untouched by the what is sometimes labeled the dirty mechanism of politics, of influence, of hidden agendas, of power play, etc., etc. Carefully, there has been created this dichotomy between, on the one hand, politics, both at the governmental level as well as at the intergovernmental level, versus the international humanitarian community that lived by certain rules and regulations for the better good of humanity, for the sole purpose of what humanitarians are for: alleviating suffering and saving lives. An issue area not to be touched by anyone outside the true humanitarian community. And that has become a very, very powerful image, a very powerful branding mechanism for the humanitarian community, to separate itself and to put itself on a pedestal of inherent goodness, of inherent proper behavior, as opposed to other actors that were always blemished, is that English? Or they were always influenced by the down-to-earth, dirty mechanism of politics. And you will agree with me that, although it's a very simple representation, of course, that the classic principles of humanitarianism can represent this legalized humanitarian approach. Humanity, neutrality, impartiality, and independence have become the core of the brands of international humanitarianism, the core of the profession of being a humanitarian, to which you had to comply, otherwise there would not be room for an organization, for an individual in the international humanitarian domain. The classic principles, as they have been codified truly only in the 1960s, by the ICRC, represents the hallmark of what true humanitarianism is. We try to alleviate suffering and to save lives out of our sense of humanity. It's human to help your fellow brothers and sisters when they are in need. We do so in a neutral way. We don't choose sides in conflicts. We don't look for root causes. We are not there to indeed decide upon who's right or who's wrong in a conflict. We are neutral. And we are also impartial in this respect, that everybody who is in need, in principle, qualifies to have his or her needs addressed, irrespective of race, religion, sex, affiliation to a political party, to a conflict party, etc., etc. We are impartial in the delivery of our aid, and we, the humanitarians, do so always in an independent way. Independence here meaning not influenced in any way by whatever kind of politics involved. Yeah? The classic principles representing 150 years of humanitarian history, the classic principles coinciding with this carefully crafted container, if you like, shielded area of humanitarians acting upon their self-codification of what humanitarianism is and who falls outside the domain of humanitarianism. And that is also represented in this rather simplistic drawing, but nevertheless an interesting one, which has been labeled the classic humanitarian pyramid, or the Dunantist legacy after Henri Dunant, in which via international humanitarian law, general instruments of international law, and of course the humanitarian principles, a sealed off physical area of humanitarian space was proclaimed. After natural disaster, but especially so in case of man-made disaster, based upon the needs assessment that humanitarian organizations would be doing concerning the needs and the necessities and the cries for help coming from a community on which suffering was inflicted, the humanitarian community would define a physical humanitarian space to which only they, the humanitarian community, it, the humanitarian community, and the recipients of aid would have access. A sealed off pyramid, a sealed off humanitarian space, entry to which was decided upon by the humanitarian organizations that lived up to the principles of humanitarianism that was just outlined on the white screen. And this is a very powerful image, won't you agree? This is the Red Cross flag planted on a hospital together with a perimeter, thou shalt not pass. Warring parties, criminal gangs, whoever, you will not have access to this humanitarian space because you do not qualify. You do not qualify to be in this space because you do not live up to the standards, or you do not meet the criteria of being a humanitarian. Again, the visualization, the representation of this model via the Red Cross flag is the most powerful image on Earth, I believe. One of the most well-known brands, if you like, of in the world that people will recognize as symbolizing this untouchable area in which people will get their needs addressed by organizations who do so out of humanity, neutrality, impartiality, and independence. Now, my most direct question to you as an audience at this very moment, and I have to continue still my lectures, of course, do you still recognize this sealed off area, this sealed off physical humanitarian space, when we take a look at the 21st century? Can you come up with examples, both in areas that have been struck by man-made disasters as well as areas that have been struck by natural disasters, that you indeed still recognize this physical humanitarian space sealed off by law, by principles, and by organizations who strictly live up to these principles. Who would be able to or willing to dare a guess whether or not this physical humanitarian space, protected, well protected for the benefit of humanity, is still in existence? Or is the setup of the lecture series just that I am the only one talking? No? I can ask questions? Please.
NSF has been known to set up hospitals and make them like exclusively no weapons, no militant behavior, no hostilities within the area.
MSF is a wonderful example of an organization like the ICRC that are the most staunch defenders of the classical approach to humanitarianism and the defenders of the humanitarian principles per se. A very powerful example. MSF is Mr. Humanitarianism itself, so to speak. You refer to hospitals. Again, a wonderful symbolism of humanitarian space. There's a hospital, you put a Red Cross on the rooftop, you draw a perimeter, and you invite all those who are in need to have their suffering addressed into the perimeters, but you exclude access for militant groups, those who do not belong there. So that still exists, in your opinion. Okay, great.
I would say that this is in danger because a lot of hospitals have been bombed, especially in Syria or in Central Africa, that have been attacked, so the emblem or the whatever sign is not so much protected as it was before.
Yeah. That's indeed, we will come to the challenges now, but that's indeed already quite visible, so that that especially MSF, and to a lesser extent ICRC, but also they have suffered losses. In Afghanistan, Kandahar, in the Central African Republic, in Syria, the conflicts have been given to us. This sealed off physical humanitarian space is under threat. The rules and regulations that for 150 years, so to speak, protected so very well the outside boundaries of this pyramid, of this Dunantist pyramid, has come under violation. Respect for IHL, knowledge of IHL, and general respect for international instruments aimed for protecting human dignity have become increasingly disrespected. And that's a very worrisome development. Not because I'm so much in love with the sealed off pyramid, because we need to reconceptualize and we need to reconsider how valid this pyramid still is, but because of the fact that there are parties in present day complex disaster situations who either unknowingly, accidentally, but also willingly are violating the very principles based upon which our humanitarian system was built. And that in a time, of course, that the need for humanitarianism, the need for humanitarian action, humanitarian aid, is greater than ever. You're no doubt familiar with the figures. Last year's report of the UNHCR indicating that approximately 62 million people are to be considered either refugees or internally displaced persons. The highest number of internally displaced persons and refugees since the ending of the Second World War. In 2017-18, ladies and gentlemen. Secondly, approximately 125 million people across the globe that more or less for their daily survival depend upon humanitarian aid. These are staggering numbers. The funding needs of our global humanitarian efforts go through the ceiling of $20-25 billion. Many promises made by international government, by governments in the international fora, but never these figures are materializing. So the humanitarian domain is in crisis, not only because of this classical depiction becoming less and less respected, but also because of the rising needs over the past 10, 20 years that have been unparalleled in history. And to instruct or to support this turning point in history, if you like, the 21st century, I wrote down a couple of these challenges that one can distinguish, and that will tell us that this classical Dunantist pyramid is very difficult to keep alive, if you like. Firstly, the humanitarian community has to be able to address the question whether this monopoly of access to humanitarian space, to the sealed-off humanitarian space, is still the proper way to go about. The humanitarian community needs to address its exclusive ownership, if you like, of humanitarian space. With the shifting geopolitical balance in the world, the upcoming rich states in the Middle East and the Far East, the re-rise or the rise or the rediscovery of faith-based organizations with also motivations to want to be in humanitarian space, this self-righteous monopoly has become more and more criticized by actors that, because of their not strict adherence to the humanitarian principles, excluded them from humanitarian space per se. Excluded them from humanitarian space based upon the well-established, well-known actors in international humanitarianism that, by unlucky chance, one might say, are quite Western-dominated. I don't want to use it as an argument, but looking back at 150 years of humanitarian action, one can see, of course, that the humanitarian sector, especially in the 1960s up until the 1990s, is heavily dominated by basically Western organizations, these big, tall, white males heading the organization and reasoning from a very Western, legalistic, philosophical paradigm, so to speak. So that was definitely in the 1990s the first and painful question that the agencies, the humanitarian agencies, had to ask themselves. But there were also more, let's say, pragmatic considerations that put question marks to this classical approach to international humanitarianism. And I wrote down a couple: Bosnia, Rwanda, Haiti, 2010, of course, and the ongoing crisis in Syria, Myanmar at this very moment, that more and more confronted the humanitarian sector with inherent and repetitive failure in delivering what the humanitarian assignment is, alleviating suffering and saving lives, that confronted the humanitarian sector with the incredible complexity of these crises or even natural disaster events in which hardly needs assessment was driving the humanitarian effort, but more the available capacity or the available supplies that determined what the humanitarian aid effort after disaster struck looked like. And finally, the realization that although we have come to quite an impressive global buildup of norms and codexes, global codification of ethical standards, of rules of behavior, codes of conduct, that is global, this global framework of norms, rules, and regulations only truly materialize when properly contextualize at the level where humanitarianism is being applied, so to speak. So these were very harsh lessons and harsh realizations that slowly built up in the 1990s, to which the humanitarian community, would it not be dwindling into unimportance, had to ask itself and had to start engaging in discussion and conceptualization for the relevance, for the benefit of the relevance of humanitarianism. Now, I'm an academic, so it's easy for me to speak. I'm not a practitioner, although I had some early 1990s experience in the United Nations. So for me, such an intellectual challenge to test existing paradigms and concepts and see how these concepts could be reformulated, readapted to meet the present day circumstances in which these concepts get their relevance and the right, is of course a wonderful assignment. For the humanitarian community, it has been a much more difficult exercise, so to speak. First and foremost, because there is a principled unwillingness to enter into discussion that will move us away from this classical humanitarian pyramid. The ICRC and MSF, it's easy to pick on them. They're the best known global examples of the staunch defenders of the classical approach to humanitarianism. The likes of MSF and ICRC refer back to this 150 years of history in which they can make the case that humanitarian action is only viable when conducted according to the strict respect for the humanitarian principles. It's of course an endless debate of yes or no, and a bit to the left, a bit to the right. ICRC, for its operation in Afghanistan, has always claimed, if it were not for our strict adherence to the principle of neutrality, we would have never been as effective as we have been over the past years in delivering humanitarian aid in Afghanistan. Others might claim that the effectiveness of ICRC has been hindered by the fact that they so strictly adhered to their stance on neutrality and impartiality. That's of course an endless debate, and it's very difficult to empirically support this choice or the other without the possibility of building up a large set of almost quantitative data in order to see where the patterns are pointing more to effectiveness thanks to the principles, or effectiveness bypassing the principles. That's not also the argument that I want to get into, but it's only to showcase the unwillingness amongst various stakeholders in the international community to truly dare to confront their own concepts and their belief systems to see whether they still match the 21st century. I should be a bit mindful. Sorry, that was a bit quicker than I expected. To confront themselves, to test their validity of their way of operation for the 21st century. Secondly, and that's perhaps going back to the Oxfam group, but to many more organizations. The humanitarian organizations cling on to a system where they have been known to become comfortable also in their relationship with their donor community. And then especially the private donations that concerned citizens around the world do to these kind of organizations depends very much upon the clean slate, if you like, of these organizations to showcase that they truly adhere to the humanitarian principles of especially neutrality and impartiality and independence for the sake of humanity. To dare to engage in discussion whether or not these principles could be watered down a bit or could be reinterpreted a bit to better match the 21st century circumstances is for them a very dangerous road. Next to the fact that this scandal, of course, also cost them already quite a few donors running away because of the negative publicity. And so there are several issues at play that do not allow many organizations to openly, honestly, willingly enter into this conceptual discussion to meet the present day challenges that formulated in a different way are now on the widescreen, indicating that through research, through quantitative and qualitative empirical studies, the issues listed here on the widescreen are not to be denied anymore. They are there, and the humanitarian community needs to find a way of accommodating itself to the new realities that we can wish were not there, but that are there anyways. The realization that harm, that aid sometimes can do more harm than good. The fact that many political actors, whether we like it or not, have entered the humanitarian domain. And Haiti was again a wonderful example, that France, Great Britain, Russia, the Chinese, oh yeah, and also the Netherlands, actively tried to get into Haiti to showcase their humanitarian spirit. But in the meantime, of course, also reestablishing their political influence in that part of the world. The use of the military, which per definition are not neutral and not impartial, so to speak, as a kind of inconvenient but useful addition to the humanitarian stakeholder mix. The continuous nastiness, if you like, that the humanitarian world and the development world on principle try to keep as separate as possible, but in reality meet one another continuously and overlap with one another continuously. And finally, and then we're back with the first slide also, the realization that victims of disaster are still human beings, and victims of disaster are still right and doubt clients of humanitarian aid, if you like, who still have also quite a bit of capacity that is often very effective to make use of in the immediate aftermath of disaster. These 21st challenges, they are not challenges, they are realities to which the humanitarian community has to find an answer in order to remain relevant. Okay, now I have to be very quick. This whole realization came to the fore during this World Humanitarian Summit in Istanbul in 2016. Many governmental leaders, heads of state, but also representatives of an enormous amount of international non-governmental organizations in the humanitarian domain came together to indeed map the present state of the humanitarian system and to see where the mismatch and the match with the present day realities is. And like so often, this major conference, the farewell gift for Ban Ki-moon, because that was basically what it was, resulted in several outcomes, especially pinpointing down towards state parties the five core responsibilities: political leadership, uphold norms, leave no one behind, etc., etc., but containing also definite admonitions to the non-governmental community. Uphold norms that safeguard humanity. Of course, first and foremost, state parties are in charge of creating an issue area of respect for international humanitarian law and to safeguard indeed the standards of what humanitarian action is all about. But also the organizations themselves need much more to see how applicable or non-applicable rules and regulations and principles are in the context of where humanitarianism is being delivered. At this very moment, a PhD student who is just finalizing his PhD on humanitarian diplomacy. He comes from a small NGO, Convoy of Hope, faith-based. And through his work, he discovered indeed that in reality, the likes of Convoy of Hope, but also MSF, are already balancing and weighing the application, the implementation of the humanitarian principles per case in which they are working, per context in which they are working, for the greater good of having access to the ones that they want to serve with their humanitarian action. Access takes, overrides the importance of a strict implementation of the humanitarian principles. So in many of these political admonitions of Ban Ki-moon to the states of the world, to the member states of the United Nations, there are also definite admonitions to the humanitarian non-governmental community, and especially in the fourth sentence, what are we doing with the humanitarian community? Are we indeed delivering aid in a repetitive manner, going back each year to the same place because a new crisis has erupted? Or are we also using humanitarianism to try to end needs and to try to address root causes of, for example, conflict or natural disasters that are being higher in frequency, for example, due to climate change? Okay, so the presentation will be for you available. So this is just a further delineation of what the outcomes have been. As a result of which the World Humanitarian Summit highlighted five key areas where, if you like, a new approach to humanitarianism should be called for, in the areas of empower people to cope and to recover with dignity, consider them to be still human beings even though they are struck by disaster, endowed with capabilities and endowed with rights, and therefore endowed with dignity and the need to restore that dignity. Make sure, indeed, in your programming, in your humanitarian programming, that a certain level of resilience is being created so that communities, disaster-prone communities, can better prepare themselves for the next round of disaster. Last week, 2 weeks ago, I was in Indonesia, and you can really see Indonesia very prone to natural disasters, that the government has now really made investments into the resilient nature of their populations to first and foremost cope with threatening disasters themselves. So well, even that when this, what's the volcano on Bali? No, that's near Yogyakarta. They have many volcanoes. Agung. When the Agung volcano threatened to erupt, the resilient mechanisms of preparedness were so well that within one day, 150,000 people were in the pre-designated areas. So much so that the system couldn't cope anymore with the best behavior of the Indonesian population to respond proactively to a threatening disaster. Okay, so NOAA has been very active during that World Humanitarian Summit. My predecessor as president, Pat Gibbons, helped to produce this public submission, as we have called it, in which we asked for a paradigm shift, a reconceptualization of international humanitarian action, by putting the disaster-struck people very much to the focus of any approach to humanitarianism, and at large to call for more effective and profound partnerships amongst the humanitarian stakeholders for the implementation. But because we are an academic network, and we also said we have an assignment over there to also go much deeper into partnerships with academic institutions, research institutions in the Global South, in Latin America, in Southeast Asia, in the Far East, etc. And that is what we are doing, and there is no global issue. And basically, the next step is indeed to make a small subdivision in how the principles of humanitarianism that have existed for so long can still retain their validity. If the substantive principles of humanity and impartiality are supported by much more operationalized principles of neutrality and independence, meaning the context will determine the effectiveness of the operation will determine how neutral and how independent we can be as organizations, or we should be as organizations. Adding a fifth principle, what I have called the people's center principle to it, and the principle of subsidiarity. Only enact the international mechanism of international humanitarian aid when you really know that it has an added value to the capacity that is always still, in whatever kind of amount, in place in the disaster-struck area. And finally, accept the new humanitarian space that, whether we like it or not, is now a permeated pyramid. The walls, the sides of the pyramid are permeated lines, creating a humanitarian space, a humanitarian arena, in a kind of abstract, metaphysical way. It can materialize here, it can materialize there. It's a fluid, if you like, concept that will allow humanitarianism to materialize there where it's needed and there where it's possible. And accept that a multitude of actors nowadays have claimed access to this more abstract humanitarian arena, for which the humanitarian community has to find a way of coping, that they are not the sole exclusive good Samaritans anymore in the humanitarian arena. So sorry that I had to rush now, because I really wanted to devote more time on this reconceptualization thing, on how also via research the humanitarian network that we are can help the humanitarian community to dare to confront this necessary discussion on the concept, the 21st century concept of international humanitarian action, as a result of which, and again, I suppose that the presentation will be made available, as a result of which the essential elements of greater localization and contextualization, both in implementation of humanitarianism as well as research on humanitarianism, coincides with the strengthening of local capacity, as a result of which humanitarianism can truly live up to the standard of trying to change, for the better of course, trying to change people's lives, in the hope that we can come to a situation that we can end need instead of continuously apply aid in a repetitive pattern of recurring disasters. So thank you very much for your attention. I couldn't resist, although she's British and I'm in Ireland, I couldn't resist to depict also a classical example of international humanitarian action according to the classic principle, the lady with the lamp, that sheds hopefully some light on my presentation. Thank you very much.